introduce the last speaker, Mathieu. But before that, I just wanted to make the announcement, two announcements. First, this conference would not have been possible if it were not for Lyon Young here. So let's say first.
This all started as a little discussion with Zung last year. He spent a semester at Shanghai Jiaotong, had a wonderful time with a lot of mathematics. And two papers came out of it. This started as a little discussion. It turned out to be more complicated than we initially thought. So we wrote it up. So I want to tell you something about presymplectic convexity. Basically, what's happening to the Atias Gellermann-Sternberg theorem, and the Dazan theorem in the basic case. Right? This is the goal. Okay, so let me, I'm not sure I can go through all of this, but it doesn't matter. I can always stop at a certain point. So I want to tell you something about, I need to introduce my notation. There is no other way. Right? I'm going to go very, very fast over this. Then I'm going to remind you of the classical convexity theorems that we are looking at. There are many, many generalizations thereof, due to many people. Right? I will tell you something about the Dazan theorem, and then I'm going to go to work. What is the presymplectic convexity theorem? I'm going to give you an idea of the proof, which is arguably not that simple. And then I'm going to start working towards a statement of the Dazan theorem. So clearly, polytops cannot be just polytops. I have to have additional information, and these are called frame momentum polytops or presymplectic toric manifolds. Then I have to tell you how I obtain them. These are the liftings and framings, and there is a notion of Morita equivalence, which in this case is an equivalence, unlike in other cases where they call it equivalence, and it isn't. And I may say something about toric orbifolds because this connects with old work of Lerman and Tolman. Yes, we recover the results in the case of orbifolds. Okay. So that's where I'm going. So my notation is very simple. M is a manifold, G is a Lie group, German G is the Lie algebra, this is the exponential, that's the dual, I have a duality pairing, I always denote it like this. This is the adjoint action, this is the coadjoint action. For me, the star is always the dual net. I never assume that there is a minus one, like other people who don't put it, and then you take derivatives, there is a minus, and you don't know where it came from. Right? No, I always write a minus one. Okay, I just define it by duality. I have a left action, and for these letters, xi, eta, zeta, elements in the Lie algebras, mu, nu, rho are in the dual, xi index m is the infinitesimal generator, and that's of course the definition. Right? Okay. If it's symplectic, I know by little omega the symplectic form, it's closed non-degenerate. A symplectic action means if I got a star here, phi g star omega is equal to omega. Then xi is locally Hamiltonian because its global flow is formed by symplectic diffeomorphisms, and here they are, it's given by the action. Now, I request that all xi m are globally Hamiltonian, so there exists a function that depends on xi such that it is Hamiltonian. This is my notation of the Hamiltonian vector fields. This is linear, I can construct this in such a way that this is linear, therefore I'm going to get a map j from m into g star, which I call the momentum map, and here is the definition. Right, j at a point m is an element in the dual, which then you pair with xi, and you get a real number. Which real number? This real valued function evaluated at m. There are conditions guaranteeing its existence and equivalence. I don't want to go into them. They are cohomological. And equivalence simply means this, that it commutes with the two actions. If g is abelian, equivalence becomes invariant, and this is all I'm going to work here. Symplectic actions that admit equivalent momentum maps are called Hamiltonian actions. So in this talk, all my work, all my groups will be tori. My manifolds are going to be compact, connected, symplectic manifolds, because that's what I want to do. That is, of course, not the end of the story. Incidentally, I should also mention that just as we finished our paper, and after we put it on the archive, Siamaro, doesn't he put a paper, this joint paper of he and Siamaro, that do the non-abelian version, they do the kernel version of it, with other techniques. Of course, we get the same result for the abelian case, but they are going in one direction, we're going in another direction. It's a beautiful thing. They don't have Morita equivalence. Our point of view was basically integrable systems. This is why we were interested. Okay, so convexity theorem. Here is the first one, Attia, Gellerman, and Sternberg. I give you omega compact connected symplectic manifold, endowed with a Hamiltonian decay action. Momentum map is J. The level sets of J are all connected, and Jm is the convex hull of the fixed point set of the action. Each connected component of the fixed point set is mapped to a vertex. In addition to that, I should have put it in the statement, the map from Jm is open with Jm, the relative topology. Okay, so I should warn you that in general, the set of extreme points of Jm does not coincide with the vertices. In other words, don't imagine that I have just points like this, and I take the convex hull, and all the vertices that you have seen are going to be at the edge. That's not true. There are interior vertices, interior walls. They are very important. And those of you who know about Deustermann-Heckmann, it's very important. This is how the polytope is being cut. All of this theorem, actually, I should tell you, I should mention this. All of these theorems are really coming from Constant's theorem. There is a remarkable theorem of Constant in 73, which is a special case of this. Where M is a coadjoint orbit, and the group that acts the torus is the Lie group underlying the Cartan algebra, right? And J becomes the projection. Yes, it's a special case. However, Constant's theorem has other generalizations, which do not have yet symplectic analogs, and it's not clear that they have. So there is much more going on here. Much more. This is one way that has completely exploded, right? But there are other generalizations of Constant that are not at all symplectic, in infinite dimensions, for example, and there are symmetric spaces where nobody knows where they come from, etc. They're very interesting, very, very interesting. Okay, so I'm going to say that an action is effective if the map G goes to phi G is injective, which is equivalent to the intersection of all isotropic groups being the identity. Here is the isotropic group definition. And there are many interesting consequences. Why do you worry? I'm going to tell you also like this lesson. Why worry? Who cares, right? Well, there are several things. I will tell you more about this as we go along. In fact, the sort of the grandfather of this theorem is an even older theorem in the 78 of Arns, Marsden, and Moncrief, who tried to show that the space of solutions of the Einstein equations is a manifold. They failed. But in failing, they discovered the quadratic nature of singularities of the momentum. They were the first ones to point out that the singularities of the momentum cannot be worse than quadratic. You are going to see this later when I show you the normal form. So, for example, let's show you some easy consequences that, you know, the standard fact about effective total decay actions, any such action has a k-dimensional orbit, which is equivalent that there is a Lie algebra, isotropy Lie algebra, which is the identity. Okay, so assume the same hypothesis of the convexity theorem. The TK action is effective, implies that the action has at least k plus one fixed points. Let me show you the proof, because it's extremely easy. The bifurcation lemma, I want to get you thinking simplistically. The bifurcation lemma states that the range of the derivative of the momentum map is the annihilator of the isotropy algebra. In bifurcation theory parlance, this means that points of bifurcations are exactly the points with symmetry. Points with symmetry are exactly the points where you have additional symmetry, and that means that when you bifurcate, you gain symmetry. Okay? This is a very important philosophical concept when you do bifurcation theory with symmetry. Now, since the action is effective, there is some M such that this is the identity. Therefore, for this M, the annihilator of the identity, is everything. Hence, Jm sits in the interior of Jm. Since on the facets of rank T of T and J, the rank of T and J drops. That's part of the proof of the convexity theorem. So Jm is a non-degenerate polytope in our case, so it must have at least k plus 1 vertices. So there you go. It's the end of the proof. Here's another one. If the TK action is effective, then the dimension of M must be at least 2k. That's even easier. Invariance of J means that J is constant on every orbit of the action. Let O be an orbit of dimension k, and I mean there. Well, it's constant, so its derivative clearly is zero. Hence, the tangent space to the orbit sits in the kernel, but I know by the reduction lemma that this is the omega orthogonal complement of that space. That's my notation for the omega orthogonal complement. So, any orbit is isotropic. I haven't used anything, right? But therefore, twice dimension of this is smaller than dimension of this plus this, but we know from linear simplistic algebra that this is the whole thing. I'm done. So there are results like this that are coming very, very easily once you know such theorems. Okay. So what is the Delzant theorem? Here I'm actually going to put on the blackboard the definitions because I have to use them over and over. So a compact connected symplectic manifold endowed with an effective Hamiltonian toral action is called the symplectic toric manifold if the dimension of the torus is exactly half the dimension of the manifold. So these are the simplest integrable systems. Right? It can't get easier than this. All periods are fixed, the set of commutative integrals are the components of the momentum. So here is what, let me define, that's not how it was done, but this is the easiest way of presenting it. A Delzant polytope delta in Rn is a convex polytope satisfying. It is simple, so there are n edges meeting at each vertex. It is rational, so the edges meeting at each vertex of V are of the form V plus T ui, where ui is in Z. Or either I forgot the parenthesis here or I put an n extra. It is smooth. If un up to un in the previous point can be chosen to be a basis of the lattice Zn. I want to write them down because they are going to show over and over in my talk. So simple, and I'm going to give you a second version of this. N edges at each vertex. Remember that delta is in Rn. So this is the N I'm talking about. It's a rational. Edges meeting at each vertex are of the form V plus T UI where ui, t is of course positive, and ui is an integer, okay? And it's smooth. I'm going to give you a slightly more geometric version of this. U1 up to un are bases of the lattice Zn. This is one way you see it. You see some other authors saying things that are slightly different. Here is, they are of course equivalent. And it depends what you're after. Sometimes one is easier to deal than the other one. So rational each, facet is given by a linear equation. With coefficients, with rational coefficients. Simple. The way it's said sometimes is that each S dimensional face has exactly n minus s faces of dimension s plus 1 adjacent to it. And the regular for any x0 on a S dimensional face, there exists complete integral affine coordinate system. I have to give it a name, H1 up to Hn, such that the polytope is locally given near x0 by a system of inequalities, and the system of inequalities is h1 of x bigger than or equal to 0 all the way up to hs of x bigger than or equal to 0. So that's an equivalent way of saying. I want to leave it on because I'm going to keep referring to this. So notice I changed the word smooth to regular. It's the same thing. It depends on the authors. Okay. So what happens in the presimplectic case? I haven't finished here. So the Zahn theorem tells me that the symplectic toric manifolds are classified by the Zahn polytopes. So what does that mean? There is a map that produces this bijective correspondence. This map is the momentum map, right? You take the momentum map, you take the momentum, the symplectic toric manifold, you look at the image of the momentum map, you get a Dazan polytope, and conversely, this is the Dazan construction. I'm not gonna repeat it here, because in the presimplectic case, it's a little bit more complicated. You go, there is a construction that if I give you a Dazan polytope, I can produce a symplectic manifold, a toral action, a momentum map such that its image is exactly this, up to isomorphism to the correct category. Okay. So what happens if I have presymplectic situation? M omega is connected, compact presymplectic of dimension 2m plus d. So let's fix the notation. That means that omega is closed and has constant corank d. Right? So the dimension of the image of the linear map going from the tangent space to the cotangent space is 2m for all x. So I always have this because I need these numbers, the 2n and the d. I assume that there is an effective presymplectic torus dq plus d. I will of course go to n plus d later when I do the sum. For the moment, I just want to do the convex, so q plus d, action on n. Here is the basis of rq plus d. Here are the infinitesimal generators. I call them x1 up to xn that go with the standard basis from 1 to q plus d. Each xi is periodic of period 1 and their flows together form dq plus d action. Assume the action is Hamiltonian. So this is an invariant momentum, which means that for each I, there is a function fi, the Hamiltonian function. Here is its definition. And this map is called the momentum map of the Hamiltonian dq plus d action. Okay. Now, if m is compact, by averaging, for example, you can simply assume that f can be made invariant, like momentum maps are not unique, right? Because they differ by cosine. But if it's compact, there's no problem, right? You can arrange it to be. Sorry.
Can you go back to one slide? Is n equal to q here, in fact?
No.
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 So you have n and you have
q. N and you have q. Like I had a TK action on a 2n dimensional manifold, right? When I go to the Z, Q is on here. Of course. Okay. So that means we are going to assume there are several assumptions that I have to do because otherwise there is nothing I can say. Kern omega lies in the tangent spaces to the orbits of the T Q plus D action. So the rank of T of the derivative is always smaller than q, and the image sits in rq plus d, on this of dimension smaller than or equal to q. So the symplectic case would be d equal to 0, and that means that omega is not degenerate. So the question is there a convexity theorem? If yes, fm is a subset of a q-dimensional fm subspace here of rq plus d, i.e. the intersection of the hyperplanes here. Okay? I need one more additional assumption. I'm going to say that the momentum map is flat if it satisfies the linearly independent affine relations on M. So here they are, just some relations, right? D of them. What does this mean geometrically? It means that Fm sits in the intersection of the hyperplanes, L1 up to Ld, let's call it L. The result is a q-dimensional object in Rn, and these Li's are just the hyperplanes given exactly by the same coefficients that I have here. Right? This is totally obvious. Okay. So this is equivalent to saying that if I take my yi to be some linear combination with exactly those coefficients of the infinitesimal generators, that all these yi's are in the kernel of omega. So, for example, this is called a flat slice. Let's take f to be now from a symplectic manifold, this is 2n plus d into rq plus d, be the momentum map of this effective Hamiltonian q plus d action on a connected compact symplectic manifold. Let L be an arbitrary q-dimensional affine subspace of this, which intersects this q plus d dimensional polytope transversally at p. So I take the intersection. Then m, which is the inverse image of p, with the pullback of omega, is a 2m plus d dimensional presymplectic manifold because of transversality, right? With the inherited Hamiltonian dq plus d action from here. The presymplectic form has constant current d, the inherited momentum map f is flat, you can check this, and this image is p. So this is what would be called a flat presymplectic slice. So this is, for example, how it appears. Right? It's very natural. You just cut. Now, if instead of taking a transversal intersection of F with an FIQ dimensional subspace, things are not so nice. So we are not going to do them. we would take a transversal intersection, we would get a P prime sum S with this image of the momentum map. This would be a curved two-dimensional submanifold. M prime would be still a presymplectic manifold with a Hamiltonian torus Q plus D action on it. The other property state, the kernel of the presymplectic form, still lies in the tangent space of the orbits at every point, but its image of the momentum map is now P prime, which is certainly not convex. So here is the theorem. Let F be a flat momentum map of a Hamiltonian torus TQ plus D action on a connected compact presymplectic manifold of this dimension, whose presymplectic form has constant core MD. Then the image F of M is a convex Q-dimensional polytope lying in a Q-dimensional FI subspace L of R Q plus D. Moreover, the pre-images are connected, and the map F onto F of M is open where F of M is endowed with a relative topology, which I forgot to write. Okay, so let me give you an idea of the proof. Okay, how this is done. Now, I'm not going to prove everything. But here is a strategy. The strategy is the following. First, I study the kernel of omega. Then I'm going to show that this presymplectic manifold, together with the Hamiltonian torus action, admits a natural local symplectization. It sits in a manifold, symplectic manifold, whose dimension is 2 times n plus d, right? From this local symplectization, we can adapt the Marold-Gilman-Sternberg normal form to find a presymplectic normal form. Then I reduce the convexity problem in the presymplectic case to the convexity result in the symplectic case. Now, I'm not going to give you all the details, but let me show you the highlights, what is involved. So let's study the kernel of omega. That was very vague. So let me show you what kind of properties I'm after. Here is a lemma. For every point y in M2n plus d, we have that the kernel of the presymplectic form sits in the tangent space to the orbit. This is my notation of the orbit, the group dot point. The vector fields y1, yd, given by equation 2, the one that I showed you before, are linearly independent and span ker omega at every point of M2n plus d. In addition, you have this identity, q plus d minus dim tn plus dy is equal to q minus the rank of the. Of course, you can cancel Q, but I wanted to show it to you this way because this number has a significance.
Excuse me, just make sure the y1, yd, the equation as the equation of the flatness.
Yeah, the condition in the flatness. Absolutely. That's what I'm talking about. The first two statements are proved together, they are technical. The last statement is an easy consequence. This map, x into omega x dot, sends this tangent space to the span of this. And its kernel is ker omega, which I already know is here, because I'm telling you that I already proved it, which is d-dimensional. Hence, the dimension of this is d plus this, and I'm finished. So I get this. And this number, either thought of it this way or that way, is called the corank of y with respect to the Hamiltonian torus action, and is denoted by corank of y. So now, the point y is regular if its corank is zero, or equivalently, the orbit through y has dimension q plus d. Or equivalently, the momentum map has rank q at y. Any way you want to think of it. The point y is maximally singular if it has rank 0 at y, in which case the orbit through y has dimension d and is a leaf of the isotropic foliation of omega. Okay, so I studied something about ker omega. Now let me show you a few other things. There exists a Hamiltonian torus TQ plus D action on M cross the disk of dimension D, okay, equipped with an appropriate symplectic form omega tilde and momentum map F tilde. Now, I simply don't have enough time to show you what this symplectic form is. This it's technical, I have to tell you, it's not the product. Definitely not the product. You pull back the symplectic form, and there are other terms that come in there. So at this point, just trust me, there is a symplectic form. And this symplectic form has remarkable properties. For each z in the disk, m cross z is presymplectic of constant rank d, and is invariant with respect to the torus dq plus d action, even though it's not the product. Denote by zero the origin of the disk. Then m cross zero, together with the pullback of omega tilde is the restriction of the TQ plus D action and of F tilde coincides with the original M on it with this pre-symplectic form and the Hamiltonian TQ plus D action and the momentum FF. So I literally have embedded it with everything I have in this setting, which is now symplectic. Moreover, this local symplectization is unique in the following natural sense. If there is an equivariant pre-symplectic embedding phi from M into some other guy, M hat, 2M plus D omega hat, from M to this symplectic manifold, equipped with the Hamiltonian TQ plus D action, then phi can be extended to an equivariant symplectic diffeomorphism from a neighborhood of M, thought of as M cross 0 in M cross D, with this symplectic form, into M hat 2M plus D. So this is very good. Very good. Okay, the third step, normal form. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you the normal form, because I know, even if you have done this once or twice, you don't remember everything. It's quite technical, I have to show it to you. I'm going to show it to you symplectically, and then I'm going to tell you immediately what's happening pre-symplectically. It's going to become obvious. The normal form is very general, it goes for non-abelian groups. It simplifies dramatically if it's abelian. And of course, I'm not going to show you the full thing, because I don't need it. I need it only for abelian. So that's what I'm going to do. Okay, so here it goes. Here is my, this is symplectic, with a Hamiltonian TK action, neutral notation now. It has nothing to do with what I told you before. So every orbit is isotropic. Split T in two, the isotropy at M, plus some complement. This complement is the orthogonal complement of Tm with respect to some positive definite inner product on T. Of course, because you have a compact group action, so you have an invariant metric. Now you say, what are you going to do if you don't have this? If you don't have this, you can still do it, because in Pallès' 68 thesis, he showed that proper momentum maps that act on a manifold have an invariant Riemannian metric. The proof is not obvious. That's why it's part of Pallès' thesis. Because you can't average. Right? But it's true. But here, there is no problem. Everything is compact, average, you're done. Right? The splitting induces a similar one on the dual. And I'm going to write T star, M, M star. So think of M star as the annihilator of Tm, or the Tm star is the annihilator of M, right? Where T star M, that's what I just did, is the annihilator, and M star is the annihilator. Okay. So, let Tm be the tangent space to the orbit, and the first thing you do is you prove something linear, which is called the Witt-Artin decomposition. Here is my symplectic manifold, with my Hamiltonian TK action, that for any point M, we have T and M splits three ways. The tangent space to the orbit, a space V, and a space W. Okay? So remember, three ways. The next thing is I'm telling you that if I take this space and I take its omega orthogonal complement, which I know is something that I better worry about by reduction theory, then this one, in fact, splits itself as the first two factors. So these first two factors are nothing else but the omega orthogonal complement of the first one. Okay? And now I can tell you much, much more. And what more I can tell you is... This is not working. Come on. V is the orthogonal complement to Tm in its omega orthogonal complement with respect to a TK M, the isotropy, invariant inner product, call it like this, in Tm. The subspace V, it's a linear space, with omega M restricted to V is a symplectic invariant subspace relative to the little group of this symplectic space, the tangent space. And this is called the symplectic normal space. The Tm action on this is a linear and is linear Hamiltonian and has the invariant momentum map, let's call it JV, which is quadratic. Here it comes, you see? It's explicitly quadratic. Okay, you're gonna see this guy coming all in a second, with full force. Where Xi V is the action of the Lie algebra, if you're a Lie algebraic, if you're a geometer, is the infinitesimal generator of the linear representation. Tn, which is the orbit, in fact is a Lagrangian subspace of the omega orthogonal complement of this. W is invariant under the little group, it's a Lagrangian complement to Tn in here. The map F, going from W to M star, defined in the only way you can possibly think of, is an equivariant isomorphism. The point is, let me get back to it, the point is that in this three-way split, the symplectic, everything is known, so everything that is interesting is going to happen here. Right? This we know is the orbit. And this is just, we know, it's the M star with this isomorphism that I gave you before. Here it is, you see. Okay, so I have this. Now I have to build a manifold. So this is done in the following way. I take Tk, I cross it with M star R and Vr. These are disks in M star and disks in Vr of radius R. And then I have this action, which is free, not because of the here, but because here, because it's just a subject. So I can take that quotient. This is the standard notation for the quotient, or the associated bundle, if you wish. Okay, here it is. And just to make sure that you know what I'm talking about, here is the action. You have to be careful, because one of them is to the right, one of them is to the left, so you have to fix it with the minus one, etc. Okay, I have my projection onto the quotient. Tk acts on yr in the only possible way you can think of, right? And this is an okay action, and it's smooth, and everything is wonderful. So there exists Tkm invariant disks, nr star in M and vr in V, of some small radius r, centered at the origin, such that yr is a symplectic manifold with the Tk invariant symplectic 2 form, let me call it this way, defined this way. Now, let's look at the formula just a little bit. So, the point is a class. A class is a triple. 1, 2, 3, right? And this is my notation of an equivalence class, the orbit. Now I have to give it two tangent vectors in this manifold. But a tangent vector on the quotient manifold is the projection of a vector above by the projection map. That's what I wrote here. T0 pi, T0 pi. Now I have to take a tangent vector somewhere here, here and here. Here I have no problem, these are vector spaces. Alpha, U, alpha 2, U2. Here I do have a problem, because it's a Lie group. So what am I going to take? I'm going to take a Lie algebra element, and I'm going to move it to the correct point, for example, by the left action. It doesn't matter, because it's abelian in this case. So, this is omega at the point vector comma vector. And I have to produce for you the symplectic form. So here it is, alpha 2, you take alpha 2 plus TV of TV JV U2 with C1, minus the other way around, plus the original symplectic form. And if R is small, you can prove that this is non-degenerate. So this is called the symplectic tube of M omega, right? I'm trying to tell you what is the slice theorem in the symplectic category, right? That's what I'm trying to do. Okay, and sure enough, here it comes. The symplectic slice theorem says that if I have M omega is a symplectic manifold together with a Hamiltonian TK action, I take a point, I build this Y with its symplectic form for small r, the symplectic cube, then there is a TK invariant neighborhood of U of M, and the TK equivariant symplectomorphism from U into UR that sends M to quote unquote the origin, E00 of that space. So that is the symplectic action. But it's not good enough. I need it with the momentum. So what is the symplectic form, the slice theorem in the category of Hamiltonian actions? So M omega is a connected state hypothesis. Here is the momentum. I take the point, I take the tube, exactly as before. I take my open neighborhood of the orbit, exactly as here. So the only question is, what can you say about the momentum map, right? Everything that I said here, it works. Well, the momentum map, it's obtained in the following way. You look at phi minus one from yr to the manifold, you restrict to u, and then you apply the original momentum map, so you get an fyr from this symplectic manifold to rk. Turns out, this is the momentum map of the action that I have given you before, right? And it has an expression. So here is my yr, I remind you what it is, with values in Rk, it's g rho v, right, the class or triple, it's f of m plus rho plus j v v. And now you see, right, f of m is a constant. M is frozen in this discussion. I take m and I want to look what's happening, right? Rho, well, I'm sorry, rho is some linear function, no problem. The worst singularities you can possibly get are quadratic. Again, I repeat the formula here so you see, so that you see it. That has tremendous consequences. Okay, now, what am I going to do next? I'm going to use my...
Can you come back?
It's the slice theorem, right? Okay. Take a point, take a tube, then it's in associated bundle, you know, flat with a disk, right? This we all know. Now you have to put the singletic category and the Hamiltonian category. That's all. But you know, the point is that I have formulas. Okay? So now what do? I take this, what I told you, I take my the point two business that I did before, with the simplification, and I'm going to fix them together, right? So this is a theorem now. So it says that if I take a connected pre-symplectic compact, of course, whose pre-symplectic form has constant rank d, Hamiltonian as dq plus d action, and associated momentum at f, satisfies the flatness condition, I take a point, I take the symplectic tube, constructed above that models the dq plus d invariant neighborhood of this orbit in the symplectization, because I can symplectize it now, via the dq plus d equivalent symplectomorphism. Then the momentum map defined this way this time from zr in r cubed plus d, I tell you who zr is, you take the tube and you look at what happens with the image of the pre-symplectic manifold, right? And this has the expression, and it has exactly the same expression as before. Where JD is the as above, BR consists of points such that this sits in L, I'm going to tell you in a moment who is L, where L is a q-dimensional linear subspace of T star such that L plus M star is T star. Okay, so who's this L? We can even be more precise. This is the vector subspace which is parallel to the q-dimensional affine subspace which contains the image fm of the momentum map by the flatness condition. The equality L plus M star is T star assures that the set BR in the theorem is a manifold and as the normal form model is regular. You have to prove this, but these are sort of the key steps. The intersection L with M star is not trivial in general. In fact, it corresponds to the face of fm which contains the point fm. And the fourth point, now you are all set. Now you try to imitate the dual proof. Usually the way it is done, the original proof was done by Morse theory. This is a beautiful proof, but it's not general enough. That I should tell you. There is a, and then we are going to use it. There is another proof that was in fact found by Molyneux. In Condevaux Molyneux, there is a paper, and then it has been formalized by Hilgert and Neb that has to do with the local global principle. And that proof is much more general. For example, if you want to prove a theorem like that, I told you there are many generalizations. For the Poissonic groups, the Morse theory proof fails. You can't use it. You use it only if you have the Lew Einstein structure on the Poissonic group. If you have the other ones in the classification of Lewandowski's orgonal, doesn't work. You have to use the other group. Okay.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Here, the presence of the moment map, we know that it's not uniquely defined.
Yes.
And here, where is
it? I fix it because I told you it's compact, so I average it. It's that moment map. The one that is invariant. I fixed it, absolutely. Yeah?
Is there a version of this theorem for transversely symplectic combinations?
soon would know. I'm not totally sure. But if there isn't, there should be. There are others, there's for log symplectic manifold, there's for Poisson groups, there is certain things in infinite dimensions. I actually don't know.
The question is what?
For transversely symplectic. It's a very natural question. Nobody needed it, so probably that's why I don't know. Okay, here is Delzant. Now, oh boy. Clearly, I'm not going to be able to do all of this, but it's okay. So I prepared my slide in such a way that I show you the theorem first, where half of the terms are not defined, but it doesn't matter. So here is the theorem. The theorem says that connected compact presymplectic toric manifolds are classified up to equivalent presymplectic diffeomorphisms by their associated frame momentum polytopes. So I have to do something to the polytope. It's not in the polytope is not enough. I need something, some additional information. And this is what I call the framing. The classification up to Morita equivalence, which again I haven't defined, of connected presymplectic toric manifolds is given by the Morita equivalence classes, which again I have not defined, of their frame momentum polytopes. So once again, I'm simply telling you that there is a Delzant theorem. Literally, the polytope is being replaced by framed polytopes. The framing is something that has to do with the symplectization, and the Delzant polytopes that include these new Delzant type polytopes for presymplectic, and the classification goes only up to an equivalent. And this equivalence is what we call Morita equivalence, which in this case is, honest to God, an equivalence. And there is an equivalence between presymplectic manifolds, and there is also what is called Morita equivalence between polytopes. So all of this is hanging together. Everything is working as you would expect. Now, in the few minutes that I have, let me define at least some terms. Okay? So let me start. Exactly like Sam said, let me put Q equal to D, Q equal to N, right? So this is what I have here. So what is a compact presymplectic toric manifold, right? It is a compact connected manifold M2N plus D of dimension X, equipped with a presymplectic structure of constant current D and the Hamiltonian torus Dn plus D action, right? Here it is, which is free almost everywhere and which satisfies the flatness condition. That is a toric presymplectic manifold for me. Okay, what am I going to do? I'm going to apply the convexity theorem. Let's see what we get. We clearly get more than what I told you before, right? So here is my presymplectic manifold with its toric manifold with its action. Okay, here is my momentum map f1 up to fn plus d. P is the image of the momentum map. It's the n-dimensional convex polytope lying in Rn plus d. By the previous theorem, this manifold, this toric manifold, admits a unique up to local isomorphism symplectization in the form of an open symplectic manifold, 2m plus 2d, omega rho, together with the Hamiltonian torus dn plus d action, which contains this in such a way that this symplectic manifold is a small tubular neighborhood of my original presymplectic manifold. And the inclusion manifold is compatible with everything inside. Compatible with the presymplectic forms, the torus action, the momentum map, which are detected, which from now on I'm not going to put hats on them, all of them are the same, only on manifolds. I'm not going to put F hat and the rho hat. So all the time the momentum map. Okay, so that's what I get. Now, if I have a sufficiently small local tubular symplectization, the image of the symplectic manifold under the momentum map is an N plus D. Dimensional locally polyhedral set Q, and P is L intersect Q, where L is an n-dimensional affine subset of Rn plus D. So Q is like an open subset of a Delzant polytope. It is proved that the faces of Q satisfy the rationality, simplicity, and regularity conditions. These guys. That's why I put them on the blackboard. So these guys satisfy all of this. We are only interested, of course, in the germ of a neighborhood of P in Q. And this is called the frame momentum power top. Okay, let me try. I have to make this precise. Okay, so there are a bunch of constructions here. So an n-dimensional convex polytop P in R capital N is called rational phased if for every facet Z of P, there is a linear function with integral coefficients Hz, here I write it down. The Cj's are integers and f1 up to fn is an integral affine coordinate system in Rn such that Hz is constant on Z but is not constant on P, of course. Next one, an injective affine map from Rn1 to Rn2 with these conditions is called an integral affine embedding from Rn1 to Rn2 if up to a translation the image eta of the lattice in Rn1, Zn1 of the integral lattice of Rn1 is a sublattice of the integral lattice Zn2 of Rn1 such that the quotient is without torsion. What does this mean? It means that the pullback of the space of integral affine functions on Rn2 to Rn1 via the map eta is exactly equal to the space of integral affine function of Rn1. You want it algebraically, it's eta star of the affine functions over Z Rn2 are actually the affine functions over Z in Rn1. If P is a polytope and eta is an integral affine embedding, then the restriction of eta to P is also called an integral affine embedding. Okay, two convex polytopes, P1 and P2, in different dimensions, are called integral affine isomorphic if there is an integral affine embedding eta from one to the other, such that the restriction of eta to P is a homeomorphism from P1 to P2, which is the image. In other words, there is an integral affine embedding from P1 into R2, whose image is P2. It's very natural. So the notion of integral affine isomorphic polytopes is equivalent. The two polytopes PP prime in the same Euclidean space are isomorphic. Then, if you look at the definition, it means that there is an integral affine transform, GLNZ, semi-direct with Rn, such that phi of P is P prime. Now, finally I come to the framing. A regular rational phased framing of a convex simple polytope, P of dimension n in Rn, is a pair, LQ. L is the n-dimensional affine subspace of Rn, which contains P. And Q is a locally polyhedral set in Rn, whose faces satisfy the rationality, simplicity, and regularity conditions over the Azad polytope, such that L intersects Q transversally, and L intersects Q is P. So what is a frame? It is the original polytope with some other del Zad that sticks to it. So guess what? What are we going to do? We are going to take the presymplectic manifold, we are going to go to a symplectization, and the P and the Q that I'm talking about, the framing, is going to be the Delzant polytope of the symplectic manifold. It's completely natural. This is what we're after. Okay, so this the convex polytope P, together with the regular rational phase framing, is called the rational phase frame polytope. So that's what the frame polytope is. Now, if I take P to be the image, and it's going to sit into some space, is the image under the flat momentum map of a presymplectic manifold, and Q is the image under the momentum map F, the one that I extended, of a symplectization, then P is called the momentum polytope of this guy. And P, together with the framing given by Q, is called the frame momentum polytope. So two n-dimensional regular phased frame polytopes P1, which are given by L1 intersect Q1, L2 intersect Q2, in Rn by T are called integral affine isomorphic if there is an affine transform in GLNZ plus D, semi-direct Rn plus D, such that phi L is equal to L2, and a neighborhood goes into a neighborhood. And now, two pre-simplified theory.
Question. So this n hat, does it have
Unless I add the boundary. Mm-hmm.
But F must be proper.
Yeah. So the torus action up to automorphism of the torus. Okay. So let me give you the theorems. So here is my presymplectic manifold, my toric manifold, here is the action. Okay? Then its momentum polytope is a convex, rational-faced, simple polytope, and its framed momentum polytope is a regular, rational-faced frame polytope. Conversely, any convex, regular, rational-faced frame polytope is the frame momentum polytope of a compact, connected, pre-simple hectoid manifold. Connected, compact, pre-simple hectoid manifolds are classified by their frame momentum polytopes. What does it mean? Two compact, pre-simple hectoid manifolds are isomorphic if and only if their corresponding frame momentum polytopes are isomorphic. It's exactly what you expect. It's the Zand line by line. It's working. The only catch was, what are the objects that you are replacing? Right? The symplectic was replaced by presymplectic. What do you replace? The polytope. By the frame polytopes. That's the message.
Could you go back to the definition of framing of P?
Yeah. So Q is the guy, and there is another P, right? P is called the momentum polytope, and P together with the framing given by Q. Ah, you want the framing, sorry. Here. Regular rational frame polytope. And now my last job.
And just in the existence of such a framing is part of the theorem.
Of course, this is not coming for free. Of course. I mean, I have to work.
You could extend like a fatten.
Are you fattening the presymplectic?
Yeah. You could fatten your
presymplectic,
but not all of them could give you.
No, I have to be careful. There is a construction, I'm not going to get to it because I'm out of time. When I start doing the Morita thing, the question is how do you build these things? And you saw in my table of contents that I'm supposed to tell you something about lifting, and about how to build it. This, in fact, is not due to us. It's due to Prato in 2001. I mean, she didn't quite say it this way, but the ideas are in that paper, right? So there is a way how to build this. It's quite concrete, right? And then there is also a notion of Morita equivalent that we introduced, and which is working. So I mean, I can't do more than this. And this would be the next thing. You have to worry about what if the plane on which you are is rational, or the plane on which you are working is irrational. It matters, unfortunately, right? So I mean, the facets and everything is rational there. But nobody, and nowhere did I say, that this space in which it sits is only given by rational coefficients. Absolutely not. You could have rational coefficients and irrational coefficients. If you have rational coefficients, you're going to end up with orbifolds. And you fall over Lermontov. And then, of course, the question arises, do our results recover Lermontov? Yes, they do. Okay? They have... They have momentum polytopes with labels on that. But if it's not rational, they cannot do it. It doesn't work. So you have to start comparing things. But you can't compare them because you end up in quasifolds. Mm-hmm. Quasifolds are not Hausdorff. How do you compare these objects? Nobody knows. So what we have done? Yeah. So what we have done is we have invented this Morita equivalence, which works in both cases. So this replaces the actual comparison. There is a way to compare, but not in the quasifold itself, via Morita equivalence.
But these quasifolds, they still have some associated grouping, a Lambron?
Yes, there is, but the space itself is one.
The space itself, and this Morita equivalence is related to
the
groupings.
Yeah, absolutely. This is the problem. So you cannot really compare, right? Lerman-Tolman did a while ago, and then they can compare it. Or before the reason it will be evidence. So that's what I wanted to tell you. There is a final theorem, of course. See, I mean, here is the construction. You asked me how do I do it, but here it is. There is a way to do this. So there is another how to do Morita equivalence, examples which are Morita equivalents and not, isomorphic, non-isomorphic of Morita equivalent, non-Morita equivalent. And finally, when I'm done, forget all before. Here it is. So if all of them are rational, you have a very nice theorem. In addition to what we have done.
Can you at least what is the definition of Morita equivalence, please?
It's they're so called Morita embeddings. It's modeled on Lidl blocks. Absolutely. That's where it comes from. We are trying to copy it. So, I have a submersion with connected fibers between two precipitated manifolds, these are the coranks. I call this Morita equivalence submersion if omega 1 is phi star omega 2, and the actions don't quite commute, I don't know how to say it, up to a homomorphism of the group. Right? Okay, and then I say the two-piece symplectic toric manifolds are called Morita equivalents. If there is a third symplectic toric manifold, together with two Morita equivalents submersions. Well, we have to show that this is an equivalence. This is hard. In fact, we don't show it like this. What we do is we are going to tell you what is Morita equivalence of the polytopes. There we prove it's an equivalence. We prove that we have a one-to-one correspondent. Therefore, the other guy is an equivalence. Like this, like that. Go like this. Okay, thanks a lot.
Okay, so about this simple equation, I think that there is an older theorem by Voltaire.
Yes.
And I think this is just it is not difficult to prove the equivalent.
That's right. We in fact refer to the Voltaire theorem. That's absolutely right.
That gives a very natural
way of doing it. Yeah. We refer to Voltaire's theorem. But we need slightly more information.
Right.
We need to be slightly more precise. That's all. Voltaire is sort of very principle. But it's true. It's one way of looking at Voltaire's theorem.
This choice of this slice.
That's right. The choice of the slice here plays an important role. That's why I started with this. You take a polytope and you cut. What do you get? Right? When you pull back, you get one of those guys. You get one of the images of a pre-symplectic guy. So I want to recover this.
But the simplification is not the symplectic normal number?
Yeah.
Of course. Also that. You know, there's a certain construct.
You didn't use the this intrinsic definition because you say it's cross T, so cross some ball.
Yes, because I need this construction. I need it.
You need this choice?
Yes, I need it because I don't need just some. It's not good enough for me. I need to recover what I have on the right hand side. You see, if I have a polytope here and I cut it with the space, I want that guy to be my polytope for the recent period. That was the first example I gave. So whatever construction I do, I must follow that.
What is the embedding theorem itself involved the choice of this split? So there is some...
There is freedom.
Ambiguity.
There's freedom, yeah.
Let me ask some question. Is there a C-star algebra that you can associate naturally to this construction? Usually if I have a group point, I take the convolution.
I didn't think about this. This is a very good question. I worked on this topic from a totally different point of view. if you know, but if you take it from Neumann algebra, then the pre-dual is liposome. And I never figured out what this has to do with operators. I told it to Voiculescu once. And I was hoping that he knows that he can tell me something. He said, I've never seen this before. For C-star algebras, I don't know what's going on. But for Neumann, for W-star algebras, I can tell you it's true. So if you take it, because the pre-dual is unique, and that has a liposome structure. The liposome structure that we know about.
But I was asking something a bit different, so I would explain.
I know, it's different.
That there's some sort of natural class of C-star algebras that comes from
that comes from that.
And it would be interesting to identify the bi-abstract inside.
We have not done this. We have not thought about it.
Any other question?
Yes. I was a little bit surprised because in the standard proof by Morse theory, in fact, convexity is almost equivalent to proving that the fiber is connected.
Yes.
Here there is no connectedness theorem of the fiber, at least in.
It appears in all the theorems.
What?
In all the theorems. It's part of the theorem.
It's part of the theorem that all the fiber is connected.
I have to prove that the fiber is connected.
How
yes.
do you prove? Because this in the standard Morse theory, it's completely interconnected. There is this induction and
you have to use these techniques of condensable. No question about it. Complicated.
But it is true in this case too.
It's true. It's absolutely true. So the three properties of the convexity theorem hold. The image is convex, the fibers are connected, the momentum map viewed as a map from the manifold onto its image, is an open map where this is endowed with a relative form. The three properties are true.
But you have to prove
it. I have to prove it.
To get the connection.
Absolutely. I have to prove it. And again, I repeat, if you look at the most theoretic proof, which is great, it does fail for Poisson views. That I tell you for a fact. It does fail. Right, if you do new Einstein, it's working. But if you do the other ones with the co-cycles, in the classification, there's a classification of all the possible liposome structures on a Lie group, a compact Lie group by Lewandowski and Zeuber, very old. And there's a list, right? And there are two other cases. And in those two other cases, most theory, at least I could not make it work. However, this other method does work.
There is no other